So thank you for being here with us. Hello and welcome to Gordon Chapel. My name is Laura Stanfield, Prichard, and I'll be here with you for about an hour to answer your questions and to talk about both the life of Leonard Bernstein and specifically the works that led up to his composition in three movements, Chichester Psalms. How many of you here are currently singing it? Do we have a mostly choir, if you teach you the choir type? That's good. Now, Leonard Bernstein is someone who, as a young child growing up in a Midwestern farm community that has only two statues in it, one of our statues was John Philip Sousa. Leonard Bernstein was one of the first names, sort of famous names from the history of contemporary classical music that I knew as a young child. My grandmother had a master's in piano performance, and so she was the main piano teacher for our, most of our county. And also went into the Amish part of the community we grew up in, East Central Illinois, and gave lessons on fully acoustic instruments and pump organs and things like that. She was the only person, as far as I and the town librarian at the time knew, that was an East Central Illinois inter-county dweller who had a subscription to the New York. And so I heard a lot about Bernstein, partly because I was born 50 years and 2 days after his birthday. My grandmother actually didn't come to the bringing the baby home party because she was doing a little concert featuring the music of still the young 50-year-old Leonard Bernstein on his 50th birthday, which they made a very early cassette tape of and sent to him. I'm not sure if he responded to that. But he's someone that I've always admired, not only because he was able to have one of the first really full-blown international careers as a conductor for American, but also because he composed music in a wide variety of idioms. Almost all of them were collaborative, or the result of commissions. Wasn't the sit at home in your studio and think deep thoughts and then write a solo piano piece that you later orchestrate when you have a commission. But he was really great at working over long periods of time with groups of people and formed lifelong friendships with many of the people with whom he collaborated. So, conductor, composer, but also a very outspoken public speaker and activist involved in causes trying to champion local, national, and international peace, both peace movements and the creation of artistic ensembles that might help to ease tensions in parts of the world. He's one of the first people to be involved with the Israeli Philharmonic. He conducted in its first years when the people playing in it were a much more even mix than they are now of Hebrew speakers and Arabic speakers. And he advocated for performing not just in highly secured concert halls with people with guns around the edge, which was common in the late 50s, early 60s, but actually right out in public, even on open battlefields after peace had been declared. He was active in befriending and sometimes memorializing major politicians and public speakers in American life. And he was someone who took advantage of technology. For his time, it would have been an unusual thought to transfer from a concert stage or a Broadway kind of theatrical setting to a little box that people would be watching at home on a tiny black and white screen. And he's the first person to start to speak about classical music publicly using television as a medium. The first series that he did lasted for a couple of years. It was called the Omnibus series of lectures. And my grandmother actually filmed those using whatever film apparatus was available at the time. So she would get someone to turn on the TV, and then at the point the 16mm little film was used, she would sit with the 16mm camera and try to film the TV show. So there are all kinds of things like that. She had an original cylinder recording device, acoustic device. You wind it up and you can put the heavy steel needle on it and you can make a cylinder recording. Basically, cylinder is a heavy wax cylinder. It looks a little bit like the inside of the cardboard tube inside of a roll of toilet paper, and you could make your own master of that. So she would do that. She would wind up, I remember in the early 70s, having me wind it up, and then when a TV or radio show would come on, we'd make our own cylinder of it. And I still have those. I've got a wind-up machine that I can works just as well, honestly, better than the internet, because it doesn't crash. And so what he did was something else I followed in my family. I'm the only person in my family that followed my grandmother into classical music. But it's interesting for me to be someone now that makes some of my living as a conductor and a lot of my living as a public speaker. And Bernstein keeps coming up throughout my life. When I was in high school in the 80s, middle summer of high school, I had the chance to represent Illinois as one of 100 kids, two from every state, in a program that in the summer that was called America's Youth in Concert. And I didn't know it at the time, but it was sponsored by the Mormon Church. And so they asked for audition tapes, and they picked two people from every state. We had a traveling band, a traveling orchestra, and a traveling chorus. We had to be in at least two things. And we came to Goucher College in Maryland and practiced. Then we went to New York, and Leonard Bernstein met with us and talked to us about music and all the different kinds of things you could do, and the list of just what he did seemed to go on forever. And then he let us see him conduct the New York Philharmonic in Edward Fisher Hall and run all around backstage and learn about, you know, doors opening and watch him through windows and all kinds of secret places in the walls of Edward Fisher Hall. And then he issued us a kind of bizarre invitation. He said, now that we are friends, and I've heard you, you know, perform, and you've heard me talk, and you've seen me conduct, anytime I'm doing something, you know, especially out in public, I tend to do these big public events, if you're around and you hear about it, show up, and, you know, I'll remember you. And I thought that was bizarre, because he met 200 of us that day, you know, New York seemed huge to me as an Illinois farm girl. And then when I was in college, four-ish years later, our glee club at Yale decided we were going to do an East Central European tour in the spring of 1990. I started planning it in 88 before the Berlin Wall and all that stuff happened. And I was in, I had to take first semester of my senior year off to help plan the glee club trip. And so I was in Berlin from the day before the wall fell through Christmas. And he showed up and he was going to do a concert in front of the wall, and he had people from London and people from Germany. And so I went up and I said, you said I can come sing anytime I want. He's like, do you know the Beethoven 9? And I didn't. And I was like, yes, sir, I know it. And you know, basically I think I had two rehearsals to learn it. But it was a, now that my husband has dragged me to Boston, I sing with him in Tanglewood Festival Chorus. It was very much that style where you're kind of sight reading from memory and you're terrified and you're memorizing as you go along for your first time singing. You're full of adrenaline and you don't forget the experience. So what I wanted to do was give you some written material that relates to the concert that many of you are singing. If you're not singing Chichester Psalms right now, of course, for Musica, I hope you will at some point, and that many of you who have interest in conducting or interest in being a church musician have a way that you can advocate it to a choir that you're singing in, even a smaller church choir, and it's a wonderful piece to learn to conduct. So, the things that I have handouts for, there are three sheets in the front. There should be 50 of each one, although it looks like the first sheet.
I put them
out
here.
Oh, you put them out there. Okay, wherever's from. It starts with the first page, and the first page concentrates on the piece Chichester Psalms itself. So I wanted to start by talking about that, since many people in the room are working on that piece in particular. It's a great example of Bernstein's work, because now that there are sort of being dissertations on the music he created during his long life, he was born in 1918, 100 years ago this year, one of the ways that his style is characterized is by the simple adjective eclectic, elements of popular music, elements of folk music, especially Latin American music, and the jazz of his time, so 50s and 60s jazz, jazz that he referred to as bebop, even if it was very slow and cool style. And the sounds of commercial television, meaning commercials, and things that his children watched on television, combined with a lot of elements of classical music that he knew and loved. So I included a couple quotes on the sheet. The first one is something that he said throughout his life, people would say, how do you write a musical? Or how do you start on one of your great symphonies? Or what advice do you have for young composers? And he was very consistent. He would say, all you need to write an excellent piece of music, all you need to do to make a great American symphony is to have a plan and not quite enough time. And for him, that was a plan that was determined by group, not just by himself. And the not quite enough time had to do with the fact that even if he gave himself, you know, a few months to work on a project, he was always doing several different kinds of jobs at the same time. So for example, during the time period that leads up to the creation of Chichester Psalms in the middle of the 60s, he was working with the New York Philharmonic. He had just taken them on their first Russia tour. They went to more than a dozen countries. They played more than 50 concerts in less than 2 months, so almost playing every single day on average. He was publishing his large-scale works. He was still working in the Broadway theater, usually with at least 5 other collaborators. He would meet privately with the choreographer. He would ask if the choreography was known, you know, show me the choreography, and do some of it. He would coach the singers himself, and he had started doing that as a young man, already working at a summer camp in Sharon, Massachusetts, when he was late high school and then throughout college age. He would coach the singers and replace them if they weren't present at rehearsals. For example, when he was 21, he decided a good summer musical for the small arts camp would be to put on Bizet's Carmen, his own version, the parts he liked. And the Carmen was not well prepared and was late for rehearsals, so he got a mop and took the mop off of the handle, put it on his head, and sang Carmen's part while he accompanied himself in a gravelly baritone until Carmen arrived and then said, well, we're done with your love song, and was the chromatic thing, and we're going right on, because I can sing it as well as you, and then she showed up on time from that. The second quote here, when there was a New York premiere of Chichester Psalms, and there were several times he had an international commission, and he said, do you mind if we just do the premiere in New York first? Usually they said, okay. Chichester, there was a little bit of a problem that Dean Hussey at Chichester Cathedral said, if he'd said, no, we don't want you to perform it in New York, then he probably would have done it anyway. So they gave permission, conducted it in New York, and there were a lot of kind of sideways comments about it being either ineffable and perfect and austere and beautiful, or sounding strangely like the Broadway stage had invaded the temple. And so he wrote a poem, and the two lines from it that are most widely quoted are here on the sheet. In the New York Times, he wrote about Chichester Psalms. It's certain to sicken a stout John Cager with its tonics and triads in E-flat major. Now, if you listen to Chichester Psalms, you might hear some E-flat major here and there, but singing it, I don't think it comes across. That's not the first thought you have, but it's a piece of E-flat major. Certainly not, you know, Schubert's Mass in E-flat. There are moments of repose, there are moments of great beauty, but there's always an element of modernity in them. So, the basic idea of the piece, he thought he would use a three-part structure. He used as his model for the overall idea of it, Stravinsky's Symphony of Psalms, which is over 30 years earlier. Stravinsky used a variety of different psalms. Some he chose because he had already thought of a tune, and he wanted a psalm text that fit onto the rhythm of the melody he'd already written. And so it's kind of, to use a modern popular word, it's a mashup of different texts. In the case of Chichester, in the case of Symphony of Psalms, you have three movements, and the middle movement starts with kind of a long, elegiac, almost like a canon, very slow fugue, maybe, that is for instruments. And Bernstein wanted to keep that idea to have one of the movements not just start right away with chorus, but have it start with instruments, using some important themes and developing them in a contrapuntal way or in a way that was able to be a little bit more harmonically experimental. So in Chichester Psalms, at the beginning of the third movement, you have a fairly long instrumental introduction, and that's his way of honoring Stravinsky that started the middle of the Symphony of Psalms with a long instrumental introduction. Now, some of you may know that Bernstein was engaged on other projects in the 40s and 50s leading up to Chichester Psalms. He was living mainly in New York, but traveling internationally, and one of his big successes right before this piece was the movie coming out of West Side Story. And West Side Story won all kinds of awards. It was a big hit at the Academy Awards, but he did not win any awards for his music because he didn't write any songs for the film. He had already written them for the Broadway show. And he'd been writing them, or working on writing them, for almost 15 years, by the late 50s, when the show premiered live on Broadway. Now, the original name for that show was Gangway, as in gangs. Gangway, exclamation point, it's kind of a joke. It's based on Romeo and Juliet, as you know, and the idea came from the choreographer who had danced Romeo and Anthony Tudor's Romeo and Juliet, and wanted to reinterpret those characters, Romeo and Juliet, in kind of a New York filter, and also deal with the fact that part of Central Manhattan was gentrifying. Part of the old neighborhoods were changing their ethnic focus, and some of the neighborhoods were slated for demolition. So originally, the gangs were going to be, the very first idea was that Juliet would be Jewish, and they were talking about the east side of the park, fairly high up, so north of where the Guggenheim Museum and the Metropolitan Museum are now, not all the way up to the very top of the park, but that neighborhood, which had gone, part of it, from being a very, very wealthy neighborhood of sort of WASP-type people, to becoming Jewish, and then starting to become more African-American. And there are actually real riots going on with people, especially youth, causing problems in front of Jewish stores and in front of African-American stores. So the original idea, Bernstein started writing some musical ideas down, was that Juliet would be Jewish, her love songs and her solo songs would be in harmonic minors, and then the contrast in music would be an African-American gang, and they would have music that was more like what was being played in the jazz clubs in New York in the late 40s and early 50s, so sort of the end of big band music, the beginning of bebop. Now in the same period, the 50s and leading into the 60s, Bernstein had a couple of children, and the children loved to sit for that great length in front of the television, which was a new problem in American society at that point. Just during the year that West Side Story came out, America went from about 30,000 television sets to 150,000 television sets just in that one 12-month period. And so Bernstein found himself getting captured in front of this box, and he said, mostly he couldn't really tolerate what his children were watching, but the show that had the best music was the Flintstones. It had kind of a bebop soundtrack to it. And so he started to, when he was in meetings, if he was kind of distracted or bored, whistle the Flintstones tune. And he said that at the point when he was working on West Side Story, originally Gangway and then East Side Story, before it was West Side Story, he had the Flintstones tune just quoted in it several times, but it seemed too lighthearted. He kept that idea in his head, and he later said, much later in the 80s, that it was one of the things that inspired the jauntiness and some of the big intervals in the big choral tune, the fast tune in the first movement of Chichester Psalms. So if you think of the Flintstones, the bum 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 bum, and he could sing one. He didn't have a fantastic singing voice, but he could carry two. I mean, he was baritone Carmen after all. He could sing one and play the other on the piano in the different meters and just keep going. And sometimes it would be the same, and sometimes it would make, you know, a perfect conjunction of a major chord, and sometimes it was just nonsense. Then he could do the opposite. He could switch, sing the other, and play the first on the piano. So that was one of his parlor tricks that he could do. Now, on this sheet, I have some other sources for text from Chichester Psalms. The first movement starts with a sort of bombastic but homophonic section. It's slow, all the texts line up, and the melody of it comes from one of the themes in the middle of Mahler's Eighth Symphony. Some of you may have sung Mahler's Eighth Symphony. It has a second movement that's all in, the first movement that's all in Latin, and the tune of it, on a soprano, so it's a soprano tune, but very low, is basically Veni, Veni Creator Spiritus, and the text is very old Latin chant text that has to do with inviting the Holy Spirit to come and to invest someone with fire, with spirit. And then a little bit later in Mahler's Eight, not actually that much later, W.H. Auden, a British poet, one of the closest friends of slightly younger Benjamin Britten, wrote his own kind of treatment of the same idea, Holy Spirit coming and investing musicians with pre this poem is called Hymn to Saint Cecilia. So it's not so much saying, Holy Spirit, come and invest me with fire, make me creative. In Auden's poem, he's saying, Saint Cecilia, patroness, patron saint of music, invest composers with immortal fire. And that's one of the pieces that Benjamin Britten felt was really British and made him nostalgic. And he spent a couple of years in New York in the early 40s, and then went to Los Angeles. It was during World War II, could have stayed here and been safe. He decided to go home, and he set him to St. Cecilia on the coal-powered ship that took him back to England along the ceremony of carols. You can hear the boat rocking in it a little bit, and you can hear the call of the kind of siren sound of St. Cecilia's voice in it. Now, Bernstein had conducted all of Mahler's symphonies by the time that he wrote this. He's very aware that that tune, bum, bum, Mahler's 8th symphony, but he adapts it just very mildly, and he uses it as the soprano tune for the opening of Chichester Psalms. He's going, ha and it starts to change. He uses that tune again at the end of all Chichester Psalms, get a little bit of a frame. He said, think of it, this is a nice room for this, think of it as sort of a Gothic-shaped window, and one post solidifying, holding up, supporting is that tune at the beginning, and then all the way to the end of the piece, you find it again. So it's sort of an arch foundation of the work. So that's the reason for the Mahler 8 comment here, chorale melody from Mahler 8. He wanted it to be the rhythm, the kind of shock value, the start and stop, the fortissimo opening, that was from Carmina Burana, Gorff's masterwork from the 30s. And he also spent some time conducting Carmina Burana. And when he would conduct it, he would turn to an audience and say, Orff has a bad rap, Orff was a peacenik just like me, Orff would have wanted nuclear disarmament just like me, Orff was a Lutheran, Orff was against war, and his work, Carmina Burana and other pieces, was co-opted by German nationalists in the 1930s and 40s. So don't think of him as a Nazi. Think of him as someone that's struggling within that system. It's a work that celebrates the human spirit. It's a work that celebrates fate and fortune. It's a work that we should all advocate for and not stereotype it because a couple of politicians in the late 30s like to do it at political rallies. So he would talk about Carmina Burana, and the piece starts a little bit like Carmina Burana, sort of, just a couple of eager words, a sudden stop, you hear the room echo, and then you start the text again. So it's kind of a mix, a little bit of Orff, a little bit of Mahler. The harmony for that opening thing was something that he had already composed. He was working with Compton and Green. You may have heard of Betty Compton and Adolph Green. Adolph Green had gone to the summer camp where Bernstein was impersonating Carmen. He had been in his Pirates of Penzance, where the pirates then had to change clothes and all be the police. And so everybody was in every scene. And so basically had sort of a mustache and a hat and a sword when you were a pirate, and you had a slightly different hat and a stick when you were a bobby. And Adolph Green had been a high school student and kind of studied under Bernstein, who was a few years older. Green and Compton went to New York at the same time that Bernstein did. He originally graduated from Harvard at a normal time, 21 years old. He enrolled in the Curtis Institute in Philadelphia, which is where Samuel Barber had gone. It was a school that both encouraged composing for voice and composers to study voice. So they required Bernstein to take voice lessons, which he said he had no natural gift for. And he played piano. And he, that summer, was a young student assistant at Tanglewood. So he got to know the people involved with the BSO. Then he was doing basically a one-year master's program, an artist diploma at Curtis. He graduated, and the next year was already assisting conductors at the BSO, conductors of the New York Philharmonic, and already at age 22 and a half was able to step in for someone who was conducting a full concert and take over the concert, and really kind of started his international reputation as a young conductor at 23, 24 years old. Now, in the piece that I was kind of talking about, the Compton and Green piece, Bernstein worked with Compton and Green from many, many years. They wrote On the Town together, for example. They worked on the ballet Fancy Free. Hutton Green helped with the storyline for that, even though it's a wordless ballet. Compton and Green wanted to develop a play that Adolph Green had been in, a Thornton Wilder play called The Skin of Our Teeth. I don't know if any of you had a chance to be in that or see that. It's great. It's basically a time-traveling global warming play. And so the two main characters are living both in New Jersey and also living through the Ice Age and living through the Great Flood and several other major events in human history. And so there are a lot of wonderful texts from that not finished abandoned musical that did get finished as little solo songs. And Bernstein didn't throw them away, they're not lost. And so some of those songs from the musical that was never fully finished, called The Skin of Our Teeth, have been performed. Some were performed in the early 70s in New York in a concert that's sort of a musical review. It had a couple of weeks run of kind of lost or unknown Bernstein songs. And then the author of an interesting, fairly new book, Jeff Gottlieb's working with Bernstein, he put on a concert in 1988 at the Jewish Museum in New York and did some parts of Chichester Psalms, just some excerpts, and did the songs from The Skin of Our Teeth that were kind of the basic early material for it. So one of the reviewers for that 1988 concert said it was like seeing a magic trick and then having the magician explain to you how it was all made, because you could kind of see where the bits were from. So I'm just gonna pass this around. It's got two post-it notes in it. One shows you the letter in Bernstein's handwriting, agreeing to do the commission for Chichester Psalms, and then it has the whole letter typed out in larger print so you can see the way that he negotiated with people who were commissioning music from him. He was asked, for example, if you could, please put a little bit of West Side Story in this piece for Chichester Cathedral, this choir of men and boys and organ. And so he said, well, he wouldn't quote from West Side Story, but he would quote from its roots. So some of its roots are the songs that would have been in East Side Story, if the gangs had stayed Jewish and African American. Some are from Gangway before that, and some are from The Skin of Our Teeth. On the handout, number one, again, the first movement, there's a 7-4 section. This is the one in Hebrew that's going, and you sing short phrases of text, and it's almost a double chorus. A lot of it's women singing two or three words and then men responding three words, and you're divided up in different ways. This is because in the Skin of Our Teeth there was a scene where the choruses were coming out from two sides of the stage. They're all singing the same text, but one chorus would sing a line of text, and whatever the last word was, this is a Compton Green trick, then the other chorus would respond, and their response would start with the word that these people had just ended with. So it sounded like one long sentence, but you would basically, one group would say, I'm starting this sentence, and they would all say and together, and then the other part would say the other part of the sentence. So I wrote on here a little bit of this. Where does he get the idea for 7-4? He gets it from Britain's Peter Grimes. And in Peter Grimes, there are several sections where choruses burst onto the stage. They have to enter while singing rounds and fugues in odd meters, fives and sevens and nines. There's one particular one where the chorus comes out and sings a tune called Old Joe Has Gone Fishing. He said, we need some Old Joe Has Gone Fishing. We need some good British contemporary music in this Chichester Psalms. So he's a quote Peter Grimes, but he uses the same idea. Now, why would Bernstein care about Britain? Peter Grimes was commissioned in Boston. Peter Grimes was commissioned to be premiered in Tanglewood. It was actually workshopped in San Francisco at Stanford a little bit first, but its kind of full stage premiere happened out of Tanglewood, and Bernstein conducted the premiere of it. So he had Britain's notes, he had Britain's original annotations. He was kind of the first person to advocate for that work. It's got a little bit of Flintstones in it, as I mentioned, the leaping around and jumping. The words originally were one chorus singing, look, here comes the sun, the shine today, it's going to be da da da, that kind of thing. So you're going back and forth with phrases of text. And that look, here comes the sun is from The Skin of Our Teeth. And that's one of the ones I mentioned was performed in 1973 on Broadway in a review. That song still exists and can be found. Second movement is very beautiful, but it's two completely different things going on. The opening melody, just the notes of it, that is written for voice and piano originally, was going to be a melody that, quote, we know as now the character of Maria in West Side Story, which originally was called Juliet, the Jewish Juliet, was going to come to a balcony. The first thing she was going to sing in the musical to introduce herself is that. Most people felt that it was just too much of a tragedy that as the characters die in Romeo and Juliet, there wouldn't even be any point in concluding the tragedy with the death of Romeo and Juliet because the characters would be dead while they were alive halfway through. Everyone would just be totally exhausted. It would be too much like watching real life on the stage. So that tune was discarded. It's obviously not a great tune for a young Puerto Rican girl. To sing in that particular key. So that was sort of shelved, and that became the boy shepherd's voice. It's the song in Hebrew that is used most frequently for Jewish funeral burial services. It's the one that has the though I walk through the valley of the shadow of the death. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, may the Lord be with me, depending on the translation you know. They did try to use the tune again for that musical, The Skin of Our Teeth. So they know in The Skin of Our Teeth that there's basically an ice age coming. And they don't quite say global warming, but they do say things very similar to it. And so the couple decides to sing a duet that's full of hope and faith that even though this ice age is going to come, it's going to kill off a lot of the world, that the world will revive. So the words that got put on that tune, the shepherd's tune in Skin of Our Teeth, were the spring will come again, summer has to follow, birds will come again, and a sting in the hollow. And it's a little silly, right? Because we know it with Hebrew words. We know that Chichester Psalms a little more elegant, I think, in Hebrew. But I have those words for you, so you can make up your own rest at the top of the verse if you want. You have that tune sung by a soloist. He wants a boy soloist. Partly he wants a boy because he's written it for an Anglican choir that is in Chichester Cathedral. Chichester is, if you think of the bottom shape of England, flat, long coast, where you have the part, sort of the boot, I guess, of England that sticks out into the west of Cornwall over here, and you have cliffs of Dover, close to France and Belgium, over in the east. Right in the center, there's a long coast that has a lot of harbors in it. Chichester is almost in the center of that area. It's a very beautiful cathedral. It had a dean of the cathedral who was really one of the last great, and there could be more in the future, but for right now, one of the last great advocates of the arts as far as spending a lot of money on the beautiful carvings that you see in churches, beautiful commissions, glass and trying to keep a mix of contemporary art, both visual and sung, and ancient art side by side. Hussey was involved when there was a project to rebuild Coventry Cathedral, which is farther up in the north, more in the center of the country, and he was a strong advocate that instead of rebuilding Coventry Cathedral in its old form, basically Gothic Cathedral, that they should leave the shell of the building as a war memorial, and then next to it, they should build a much more modern building with modern stained glass and modern art, and that's where Britain's War Memorial was premiered to reconsecrate that sacred space. Now, Hussey wrote to Bernstein, having seen West Side Story, and said, I'm aware of your symphonic work, I'm aware that you're Jewish, I'm aware that you have background working with a variety of choirs, especially the old European model of Beethoven saying, I want to do a mass or a symphony with horses and calling up local cathedral choirs to have highly trained boys singing soprano and men singing alto with your bass. So you can do whatever you want. You can write for our choirs, boy choir, sopranos, and men singing alto, tenor, and bass. We don't usually have an orchestra, but you can require an orchestra if you want. We have a wonderful pair of organs, a little bit similar to what's going on in Paris in the Romantic period, a really big organ in the back of the church. In French, the player of that would be the head of the music program at a church, the titulaire, the person that's the main organist. And then they have a smaller organ in the front where the choir is in the chancel, and have a separate player and coacher of the choir. So he could use whatever you want. He could use two full organs, he could use orchestra, and because he was given a lot of choices, it took him over a year to fulfill the permission. He kept changing his mind. He was Jewish. He was born in 1918 in Lawrence, Massachusetts, but he did not come from a family that kept kosher or sent him to Hebrew school for years and years. So he decided he would use some of the Psalms because of Stravinsky, but it took him a while to decide whether to use them in English or another language. He decided Hebrew. And then he had to get someone to write out Hebrew songs for him in American letters and go through with him and say exactly how they should be accented. That's not so unusual in the history of major composers writing large-scale choral works. Think, for example, of George Frederick Handel being basically a young German boy educated in Italy, fluent in Italian, who ends up, because of political changes in London, he is wishing he could be an Italian opera composer. Italian opera is fading in the public imagination. He finds funding, he gets commissions to write English language concert works, sacred oratorios, and then he has to get in carriages and go in the middle of the night to the librettist's apartment, throw rocks up, and say, you know, one syllable or two when he's setting the test. And he takes notes and he tries to be very careful about it. Bernstein's seen a little bit of that with Hebrew. When they created the text at the beginning of the choral score, Chichester Psalms, they did not use the standard way of transliterating it. It's a little bit difficult to read. So the other several pages of what I gave you in the handout is a two-page handout that has the Hebrew text that in long lines that's read from right to left and underneath it a transliteration. And then sort of a way of sounding it out. So for example, you just use this page. Give me a second. You have a page that has Hebrew on it. You have a second line which reads from left to right rather than right from left. So this isn't lined up perfectly under a Hebrew letter with an Arabic or English letter. So I'm looking at the second page of it, which says Alme Nuhot. And underneath it, I wrote out a little bit more of a sort of an American phonetic way of pronouncing it. I did not use IPA, because honestly, my husband despises IPA. So he has this way of writing out words. He sings in, for his bass soloist, he sings in Russian, he sings in other languages. So he has a certain way he likes me to write out how to say the words. So I used my Prichard system. Thank you for that. And he actually is on Facebook, so I'll be glad he sees that. On the other three pages of the handout, you have the text just transliterated, roughly the way that you would sing it, hurrah, and underneath each word, a word-for-word translation. So if you have a basic idea of what you're singing, this is the page that's like, wake up and sing. That's fine. That'll get you through a concert. But if you want to know which word is harp and which word is wake up and, you know, that kind of thing, what are all the little V's, the V here and there, this will give you a little bit more of a specific word-for-word and kind of letter-for-letter example. Now, I was halfway through Chichester Psalms, so the first movement we talked about, the second movement begins with a beautiful, peaceful, turns out, shepherd song, David, and then that is interrupted by the men of the chorus, and depending on how flexible the conductor is, they might also let the women sing along with the men on the high tenor part, sort of G's and A's and B's, that kind of thing. That music was originally, had a couple of uses. The first way that it was going to be used was music of a Jewish gang in East Side Story. Then they kept it when when they switched the location from the east side over to the west side, both gangs eventually were Catholic, and they became Puerto Rican and Polish American. So they just transformed that number, and it was going to be almost the very first thing that the Jets gang sang in Act 1, Scene 1 of West Side Story. And they actually performed that, and it was called Mix, and they used the word mix a lot in it, so that later, when the character of Anita, like Juliet's sister, says they're going to mix them up tonight, then you're supposed to kind of recall that opening song and dance. And it had English words, of course, it's the Broadway musical, but the rhythm and the tune were the same as what the men sing now under the Hebrew text, Mamarashim, Mamarashim, da-da-da-da-da, da-da-da-da-da-da, da. And then I think in the Hebrew you have to go woo on a high note, just the letter oo, a few other things. Those sudden exclamations, I think they might even say, that was when the Jets would be going mix, 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 meaning fight, and they would flash their little knives at that point. So it does have a warlike quality to it, and it's a very direct translation from the two gangs building up tension and fighting each other to the idea of two nations at war with each other. So the text that Bernstein chose for that, the Hebrew text, is why do the nations rage against each other? And the other reason, the reason that the number got cut and replaced with a different starting number for the Jets, they had to write it after the tryouts in Washington. They decided that the English text was too rough, so I just gave a couple of quotes. There was some racist language to kind of establish the Jets as a gang that thought of themselves as white and were going to be fighting a gang that they thought of as not white. So things like using the word brown, using the word greasy, and mentioning that the other gang was going to be Puerto Rican. So that was seen as a little bit too much for the opening scene. That number was just completely taken out. Bernstein basically took it and said, I love this music, I have to use it later, put it in a drawer, and saved it until he had a year off in the New York Philharmonic, was working on the Chichester Psalms. He did want the tune that was going to be Juliet's Jewish song to go over the top of the Jets' mix song, even before it became a song for the Jets. It was all from East Side Story, the original conception of the two songs going together, and the men's music being exactly twice as fast as the tune for the sweet, high, treble voice. In the last movement, which is Chichester Psalms, I mentioned already, it starts with a big orchestral number. There are a lot of different things that Bernstein mentioned in the late 60s through the late 80s that he said inspired some of his musical ideas for the third movement. He uses that same Mahler melody. When you listen closely to the orchestration, if you hear a full orchestral version of Chichester Psalms, there are even little fragments on muted trumpet of that Juliet tune, the David Shepherd tune, in the opening bit. And some of the harmony is directly quoted, it's even in the same key as Arnold Schoenberg's a cappella piece from the beginning of the century called Frieda auf Erden, a plea for peace, set in a very famous German, maybe Austrian, but German language expressionist poem about angels and the sounds of the heavenly spheres. And it's fairly dissonant, and it's meant to kind of shock you and be the opposite of a soothing congregational chorale, kind of put into play the idea that maybe peace isn't possible, and how could you strive for peace? So after all that dissonance, you have a little bit of resolution, and then he creates a section in 10-4. And you don't ever have anyone conducting in 10, basically going 1-2-3, 1-2, 1-2, 1-2, that kind of thing. And so it's just a very gentle lilt to it. And as a joke, when he was working on the tune, he called it his Hawaiian Palms number. Palms being a mixed up version of the word song, as a joke. And he said whenever he heard choirs practicing, if they blended perfectly on the sound of awe, he would see swaying girls in hula skirts and palms behind them on a beach on a warm day. Sort of the opposite of the tension of the second movement of the dramatic scene. It's also a tune that was going to go into the skin of our teeth, and then it concludes, as I mentioned, with the same chorale tune that comes out of Mahler's 8. The words from Skin of Our Teeth are not fully extant. You can't sing that duet. but it is a duet that would have happened right at the very end of that musical. And he called it the war duet, sort of the survivors after a war. And the first words to it, "You survived, we never took the time," that kind of thing. I wanted to pass around a few things for those that are interested. Bernstein wrote a lot of other works that call for a large chorus. Have a Missa Brevis. I'll just kind of pass these around. People can look at them and pass them to neighbors. His third symphony, that's called Kaddish, is one that requires large chorus. He wrote a piece just a little bit after Chichester Psalms called Mass, which has parts in English, parts in Hebrew, parts for rock singers. The priest character is actually a guitarist in it, so there's sort of a late 60s folk rock guitarist. And it is a piece that was written for the Kennedy Center. Bernstein had been there for the opening of the Kennedy Center. He conducted the first three concerts that helped to raise money and dedicate the Kennedy Center. He also was very involved, as I said, this is the score of Mass as well. He was involved in eulogizing some of the great public figures of his own time. He, for example, decided to conduct the slow movement of Mahler's Fifth Symphony rather than movement from a Requiem at Robert Kennedy's funeral mass in New York. He was involved in the civil rights movement, and that when Harry Belafonte put on a series of concerts during the Great Selma March to Montgomery, the night before the last day of the march, which was people camping out actually in a Catholic sort of seminary school outside of Montgomery, they put on a huge event all evening, full of stars, that had people from Broadway and people from the R&B world, and Bernstein was there conducting. Harry Belafonte paid for the whole thing himself, and Bernstein said that was one of the most important things he did in the 60s, was to be involved in that moment, the Selma to Montgomery moment. He also, as I mentioned, was an advocate of nuclear disarmament, and starting in the mid-80s, he started speaking publicly on this. He'd be hired to speak about music, and he'd show up and start talking about nuclear disarmament. The year that I graduated from college, we tried to get him to come and speak at our college. He went to Johns Hopkins instead and gave a 30-minute discussion on nuclear disarmament. He was one of the first people to put together large-scale fundraisers for AIDS research and to advocate for people with that disease to be helped and maybe cured instead of disposed of by society. As I mentioned, he was very involved with traveling in the Middle East, and he found that he was more successful by planning concerts in unusual places and asking different groups of people that might not come together to play together, to sing together, to sit and listen to concerts together. That was a way of starting a conversation than he was by giving speeches to Israeli audiences or to Palestinian audiences. As far as someone who's from Massachusetts and kind of goes out into the wider world, he always had just a little bit of that Lawrence, Massachusetts accent, a little bit of downtown Boston, and he could do the Boston Ramen accent very well. And he actually did want to originally live here. After he graduated from Harvard, got his degree from Curtis, he came back and he lived in a house in Newton. And actually physically hung a shingle outside of the house saying Leonard Bernstein available for piano lessons. And within about 2 years, and I, you know, that's not a great way to get students, and then went to New York from there. Once he was in New York, once he had kind of been discovered and had an opportunity to lead a major ensemble in an international way, in an international podium, his career took off in a way that no American conductors had. He was the first American to conduct at La Scala Opera House. He's, as I mentioned, one of the first people to use TV not just as a method of publicity, but a method of mass education. And he's one of the first people to advocate for each different new step in late 20th century recording technology. He makes one of the first CDs. And he advocates for schools to have computers in the late 80s, which was, I mean, my husband knew about that. He's an engineer, geek type kid. Had an Apple II, a Lisa when it came out, you know, that kind of thing. And he didn't compose with it. He composed by hand. He wrote all his letters to friends, like by hand, didn't even use a typewriter. But really was encouraging of younger generations to try new things, not copy his works. He did not give composition lessons at any point in his life. He didn't teach in a university kind of classroom setting, but saw the whole world as his classroom. So I want to just play you one quick thing, and this is from a work called Trouble in Tahiti. It is a work that kind of makes fun of his parents. They're basically five characters. Three characters are a backup jazz trio, and they sing comic words that sound like they're coming from commercials. And the other two main characters are a woman and a man, and they are struggling through suburban married life. And so I want to play just a little bit of the jazz trio, because this is music that's a little bit contemporaneous to Chichester Psalms as well. Let's see if we can get this to work. And there's a score of Trouble in Tahiti. Lost lyric operas doing that. And any problem. Along with this, are we going to rock and support.